Hello and welcome to Capital Conversations. This is NET News' weekly series of discussions with Nebraskans whose decisions affect the rest of our lives. With me today is Senator Les Seiler from Hastings, Chairman of the Judiciary Committee. Thanks very much for coming in.
It's my pleasure.
I was looking up your bio a little bit. You were born in Red Cloud. You went to Wayne State for college and law college here in Lincoln. You've worked in Omaha, Hastings. Were you staying a step ahead of the revenuers or what?
No, it just worked out that way. I was in the Attorney General's office having a happy practice staff for law school. And my favorite uncle sent me a notice that said March 10th on my birthday, I'm to report for Fort Campbell, Kentucky.
That would be Uncle Sam.
Yes.
And so
I went to the military for a while and then came back and they had filled the position at the Attorney General's office. So a position at Metropolitan Utilities District was available. And I took it, and then we had a little girl and decided we'd rather raise a family in a smaller community, and Hastings offered us the opportunity, and we moved there and been there ever since.
Okay. Loved it. And you've been in the legislature. This is your fourth year?
Third.
And you're chairman of the Judiciary Committee, which is kind of like herding cats, I guess, sometimes.
It's been accused of that, oh,
yeah.
Yes.
I want to ask you about the bill that you've named your priority and how it fits into the whole prison situation here.
Right. I named it a mandatory minimums as a part of my priority bill because during the 80s, the tough on crime situation took a lot of the discretion away from the district judges on sentencing. And having worked in the judicial system for 48 years, I just had a hard time understanding why that people didn't have the faith in the judges, because looking back over my history, I can see that they're very, very seldom were the judges wrong.
Mm-hmm.
And so they have the whole file. I mean, the truth of the matter is they have the entire background of the prisoner. They have the crimes he committed, what damage he did emotionally or physically mm-hmm. to the people. Why not let him make the decision? Why should the legislature say, oh, judge, you got to start at a certain point?
So what would this bill do to change that, and what effect would it have on prison populations?
Well, I believe that a couple things. One is during that maximum minimum, good time doesn't start to run.
Okay, now we're going to lose people here. This is so complicated. Dumb it down for us.
Okay. Well, the mandatory minimum says that you've got to serve like 10 years. The good time, that's about 50% of the maximum sentence you get, is cut in half. Well, the judges have already calculated that in when they sentence them. But the good time that you've got coming doesn't start to apply until you've served that first period of time, which was dictated by the statutes.
Right.
And that's the part that I think is wrong. The judges ought to have the full discretion in there for looking at each individual case.
Mm-hmm. Because now it's kind of a mixture. Here's the time you're serving because the legislature says you do.
Right.
And here's the time that the judge
is giving you.
Yeah.
That's exactly right. And I think that we set the policy, but we don't set the jail time.
Okay. So if you give it back to the judges, will that reduce the overcrowding problem?
It can. I think it will. Looking at two things. One, it'll reduce the overcrowding population over a period of time.
Mm-hmm.
Second, people understand what they're serving. We just went through hearings last summer where the prison people didn't even understand what they were doing with the prison time and how to calculate how many days that person's got to serve.
Mm-hmm. There's another bill that would change the punishments for certain crimes. It would lower them for a lot, or it would
right.
reduce the period of time. And the county attorneys want to re-up it for some of them, and I think your committee hasn't gone along, you haven't finalized it, but you're not inclined to go along with it, and it's things like including use of explosive to commit a felony, burglary. Why not? Why do you want to lessen the penalties for those kind of things?
The reason we haven't gone forward is we've got a split in our committee as to how we're going to handle those. Those are legitimate questions to be asked, and we have to answer.
Okay.
The burglary, at first you think burglary, well, that's breaking into your house. Well, the trauma to the people in that house is a lot more than just if the person broke into an empty house.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and those kind, and that again goes back to where I'm saying the judge has the facts all before him.
Mm-hmm.
So let him make that decision. But you're right, the Council of State Governments did recommend about 10, I think there are there in a list. If you say there's 11, I'll believe you. But but around 10 different changes, and lowered it from 0 to 4, I believe was the years that they recommended. I think there's a compromise that we're working on from 0 to 20. And then again, the judge has that discretion.
Mm. So he'd have the discretion, he or she would have the discretion to make it a lot longer.
Absolutely.
Huh. Okay.
Depending on the fact situation.
Now, there was a hearing the other day before the Appropriations Committee that included prison construction and establishing a mental health facility in your hometown of Hastings. But it sounds like that's all sort of on hold for now. What's going on with that?
It's really pretty simple. One, Director Frakes is just on board.
This is the new director.
The new director of prisons.
Yeah.
The director of Health and Human Services hasn't even got on board yet. Doesn't come until April 2nd. We're talking about spending $42 million in a building in concrete and $14 million a year in services. Costs, operational costs.
This is the mental health facility.
That's a mental health facility in Hastings. If you look at that, you want to be right on. What we need to do, and I argued it yesterday in front of the committee, we need to start right at the very beginning when the person enters the prison system and analyze the mental illness. Rough numbers that came before our committee last summer was that 31% of the people in the prison have mental illness. Now, that includes alcohol abuse and drug abuse.
So, and Director Frakes said that that was a lot higher than where he came from, the state of Washington,
right? That's correct. He did say that.
So what are we to make of that?
Well, what we can make of it, real simple. 1996, the governor decided that we didn't need regional centers. Closed them. The mental health people, seeing that their jobs were going to be lost, left the state. And then he said the governor's position was, we'll do it at the city level, community health programs. No money was ever given to them to do it.
Hmm.
So it just didn't happen. Those people are now in our criminal system. And that's why I would expect that there would be more than what Washington has, the state of Washington.
So long term, you wave your magic wand. What's the solution to all this?
The solution is getting these to stop recidivism. That's the biggest contributor to overcrowdedness. And recidivism is committing one crime after another. Think about it. If a mentally ill person commits a crime, most people on their first offense get a slap on the hands. No question about it. And probably rightfully, a rightful decision. Second crime, for the same person, the judge is going to tap him.
Mm-hmm.
The third time, he's really going to hammer him.
Mm-hmm.
And what that does is fills up the pen with people that have gotten no training. We have no training whatsoever for programming for substance abuse, drug abuse, or mental illness. We have no training for career path. The work ethic camp out at McCook is a holding cell now. They're not doing anything out there except holding prisoners. We got to get back, and we've got a proposal before us right now for 200 jobs that the manufacturer will come in and train 200 people.
So is any of that going to happen this year, or is everything on hold while we wait for the new director to?
Well, I think the director probably walked away from that meeting yesterday thinking he better speed up his program, and I think he will. I heard one senator tell me they think he's drinking from a fire hose, and I think that's probably right. All you have to do is go back and look at the 424 hearing.
That was the special committee that investigated the prisons last year.
That's right. It was broken from the get-go. I mean, from
the committee or the prisons? I mean, you were on the committee.
I know. We were probably broken, too. I'll tell you one thing, Fred. We were absolutely amazed at how broken it was.
Mm-hmm. I remember at one point you referred to a country song.
Yeah. I made the reference to for songs and Western songs. That's what that tune should be, and that's reserved for that, not here. Yeah. But anyway, that part of it, I'm sure he's swamped with.
Yeah.
Because it wasn't just broken at one level or two levels or three levels. The whole system was in chaos.
Okay.
At least that was my opinion, and I spent a lot of time on that hearings down here.
Well, we'll be watching as you sort through the various solutions that have been proposed, and we guess we should know something by the end of the session, right?
It would be, and it'll be. It's not going to be a quick fix. That's the problem.
Yeah.
It's not a quick fix. We didn't get into this overnight. We're not going to get out of it overnight, and we're going to have to make up time for the 10 years we sat on our hands, or 15 years, or wherever you can go back and trace where it started. It didn't happen overnight, and the solution's not going to happen overnight. But the key is to get on board, everybody get on board, the senators and the director's staff and the Health and Human Services director when that person gets here, and get a program going. And
okay.
I think we will.
All right.
We will.
We'll be watching. Thanks. Thanks for coming in.
My pleasure.
Senator Les Seiler from Hastings. This is NET News Capital Conversations. We're on the web at netnebraska.org/news. We'll have another conversation next week and hope to see you then.